in a way, as I understand. Could you talk a little bit about the genesis of this project and your relationship with the band?
Thanks, Rhys. Yes, I can. I grew up in Brisbane, born and bred, a Brizzy boy, and I lived in a suburb called Toowong in the late 70s, early 80s, and I went to a high school near a shop called the Dawn Music Centre, and I got a grant to make a short film, and I was on TV, I was on Today and Tonight, the local current affairs show, and we'd walk into the shop, and Damien Nelson, who ran the shop, said, "Hey, you that kid that was on this show making a film?" I said, "Yeah, that's me." And Damien said, "We're making a film with these guys, Graham McLennan, Rob Forster from the Go-Betweens." And that shop, that community, that world basically changed my life. And I wouldn't be here tonight if it wasn't for Damien asking me that question. And me meeting Robert and Grant, and it started this amazing adventure, which was a world of art, cinema, music, and just living a creative life. And the Go-Betweens have been sort of a spiritual path for me, and it was such a privilege to be able to finally be in a position to tell their story. So it's very much a personal film for me, and I'm just so honoured and privileged to be able to be here tonight and have you see it. So thanks. Yeah.
And Robert, your music has always been about vulnerability and personal storytelling, but how different is that experience to being a part of film like this, which delves into such complex relationships over such a long time?
Well, first of all, I felt confident because Kriv was making it, and I knew that. Having known Kriv, that he would make it with high poetic intent, that it wouldn't be a normal rock documentary, that Kriv would take it someplace else, which he has. I knew he'd make a film, a movie, and not so much a rock documentary. With the Go-Betweens, it's always the further you can take it away from the form, the better and more interesting it will be. And I knew Kriv would do that. And so I had faith in him and the project. And I knew that he could convince the rest of the band to take part, and all the other people that knew the band to take part. And watching myself in the film, and I wish I was a little bit more funny. I come across a little bit more serious than I think I should. So, you know, when Kriv makes part two, I'll be ready. And yeah, but no, it's a great experience, and I feel very comfortable in the film and watching it.
We'll look forward to the gag reel. How long was the process in getting it made, and was it difficult getting the trust of everyone involved? I mean, obviously it's a very, there's so much intimate storytelling. How did you go about fostering that trust?
rock and roll. The film actually happened very quickly in relative terms. We shot the film very quickly. We actually shot it last year across November and December. But I met with Robert about a year before that, because I had the idea and I pitched it to a company called Essential Media. And It was the hardest thing, I think, was getting everyone involved, making sure that they felt comfortable and that I earned their trust. And obviously, I took Lindy and Amanda out for dinner. It was probably one of the most grueling evenings of my life, trying to convince them that no, this wasn't going to be a piece of propaganda for anyone, that I wanted to tell the story as democratically and as evenly as possible. And seriously, once Lindy and Amanda agreed to be part of the story, I knew that we could go ahead and make the film. And it happened very quickly. So we shot the film, as I said, over the last 2 months of last year, and we cut it up until April. And so I wrote a script, and it was very clear there was a three-act structure. It was going to be, you know, the story of the band, which is sort of an idea I had been harboring for a number of years, because the band, I guess since Grant's death, that story had become in a way sort of sealed. There was a beginning, a middle, and an end, and I knew there was a story there. And once I knew that I had all the players on board, or all the cast on board, I knew I could go ahead and make it. So it was just a very pragmatic approach to getting everyone to turn up to that house, tell their stories, and then make the film in the time we had. Yeah.
And for you, Robert, you've recently written your own recollections of this period of time in book form. I wonder, what were the things that were maybe the most pleasurable and most difficult to hand over to someone else's telling of something which you've lived so intensely?
I knew that probably the most, there's two points perhaps that I could see were going to be the most difficult. And when I wrote my book, Grant and I, these were pivotal points, not difficult to write actually. I mean, the hardest thing to write is not the most dramatic stuff, it's the stuff where, you know, like the band's not doing anything for 3 months and you go write a paragraph about that. But if it's like the band breakup in 1989 or, you know, Grant's passing, there's a lot of material there. And so in the film, you know, being interviewed and knowing that, you know, like the breakup of the band was coming up and the sections about Grant's passing, I knew that it was Kriv's film. That was the thing. I had no creative control in it, and I didn't want to have any creative control in it. I just Kriv would just say, you're going to be picked up at your house at 7 o'clock. You're going to be driven out to Bow Desert to a farmhouse. We'll have coffee waiting, and we'll start talking at 9 o'clock. And really, that's what you want, you know. You just want that open slate and just, you know, give into it and go with it.
It's impossible to see anyone, but I think there are mics out there. Is that right? Yes. Is it possible to lift the lights in the audience a little bit? Anyway, has anyone ever... We'll do that. Does anybody have a question for either of these two gentlemen? No doubt you do. We'll try and see.
Just a question for Kriv. Why the reenactment scenes in the film? You didn't appear to be short of historical footage.
That's a great question. Look, I grew up in Brisbane, and to me, there was an iconography and a sort of a visual vocabulary about my recollection of the band that was very vivid to me as a filmmaker. And my idea was at one point I wanted to make a film, a fictional film about the Go-Betweens, about a band like the Go-Betweens. And I wanted it to be about these beautiful houses in Queensland, these hills, this sort of subtropical climate, boys in bell-bottom jeans and t-shirts with acoustic guitars driving around in Ford Falcon cars. To me, that imagery as a filmmaker is, you know, it's very vivid. And I really wanted a chance to imbue the film with what I call a bit of time travel. And I was very precise and specific about the images I wanted to recreate. And I had a finite budget. All those recreations were literally shot in one day. And to me, they were very important to give the film sort of a visual and emotional scope. I didn't want the film just to be about people talking in front of mixing desks or in pubs. I wanted the film to be a cinematic experience, which is what, to me, the go-between's music is. It's cinematic, it's poetic, it's every song is like a novel. And I wanted the film to have that epic feel, because, as I said earlier, these guys inspired me. And there's something about their story that is, to me, quintessentially Australian, quintessentially Brisbane, quintessentially Queensland. And I wanted to give those moments some kind of visual identity. So those reenactments were very specific and designed very specifically. So, yeah, it was very important to me that the film had that dimension, that it had that scope.
You waiting there with a question for Rob? We really can't see anything.
Congratulations on such a great document, documenting the band. To me, Go Between, especially in the early days, reminded me of folk blues artists like Sun Hansen, Skip James, rather than pop band, really. Grant, if you had your chance again to go back 40 years, what would you do differently?
Can you ask that question again?
If you could go back 40 years, is there anything you do differently? I mean, you just seem disappointed, really, in some ways. Would you do it differently or not, or are you happy with the way it's...
Look, I don't think we really have the talent to do it differently. We were working with limited resources. We were in Brisbane. I taught Grant to play the bass. It's amazing we got as far as we did.
Any other questions out there? Some amazing archival stuff sourced from a lot of people, and I remember Kriv sending out messages asking for old concert stuff and things. Were there things that surprised you, Robert, to come across, old videos or photographs? And also, those hairstyles, so many.
there's a lovely interview with Grant, which happens around 1983-84, which I've never seen. He's doing it with it's in Sydney, I don't know what TV show it is. It's Grant by himself, and he's talking about Spring Hill Fair. And he's talking with a journalist called Ed St. John, I believe, who was a Sydney journalist at the time. And I haven't seen that, and it's really lovely to see Grant by himself without me, you know, like, robbing my nipples. No sort of, you know, like, hammy visual distractions. It's just pure Grant. And it's really good. And there's a moment right at the end of it which the camera holds on. I don't know if it's on the TV show, but, and Grant just sort of dips his head and he smiles to himself in a sort of self-conscious way. But that was, like, really a beautiful moment for me, you know, like, just seeing Grant, you know, like, first of all, do the interview by himself, but also just at the end when he dips his head and just smiles to himself was, it was just pure grandeur. It was just lovely to see that on camera. And I had never seen that before, or I hadn't seen it since 1984.
That was a very beautiful moment. There's a question up the back.
I just wanted to ask you how influenced you were, or if you've read Robert's book. I was struck by, with just possibly unintentional, how they complement the film and Robert's memoir, if it could be called that, complement one another. The objectivity, the poetry, and the way you have constructed the film, it struck me very in a similar way to how Robert had constructed his memoir, and I wondered how influenced you were by his memoir, if at all.
Well, when I first pitched the idea to Rob, we met in a cafe just near The Gap in September of 2016. And I said, Robert, I want to make this film. And Robert said, that's interesting, because I'm writing a biography, or an autobiography, called Grant and I. I went, oh, wow. And there was a strange sense of alchemy that he was writing this book, and I was thinking of this idea. And Robert very generously let me read not a transcript, but a very early pressing of the book. And I read the book, and Robert said, look, this is just my version of the events. And when he said that, when he gave me that preface, I went, okay, great. And I read the book, and I went, yeah, this is Robert's story. This is Robert's version of the story. And there were a lot of things I gleaned out of that book that I stole out of the book, like the image, a lot of imagery, basically, of Robert and Grant fencing in front of the Avalon Theatre, and various things that I, you know, I'm a filmmaker, so I'm, you know, I'm a thief. So I took that, but the book was great because I knew where Robert went with the story, and what was exciting was to be able to go and talk to everyone else, and I always said to Robert, look, I'm going to make this film, and there's a really great biography that I read when I was in my early 20s about Edie Sedgwick, that was just, basically the book was, you know, an account of Edie Sedgwick's life through various people's perspectives, and it was just, you know, the book was basically just all these points of view, so it was like kind of like a Rashomon book about the events and how everyone perceived the events. And I knew that I had Robert's side of the story, but I wanted everyone else's. So Robert's book was sort of a great starting point. And Robert deliberately in the book, he didn't put any images or any pictures in the book because he wanted the book to be a piece of literature. And the film, I think, acts in parallel. It's not the book, but it's sort of a visual account of that story with everyone else's story. So yeah, so it's sort of like we jammed.
On a purely storytelling level, I mean, obviously, Robert, you've always written so visually. How difficult or strange is it to listen to your experiences recounted through so many different perspectives of reading?
I always feel comfortable with people interpreting or commenting upon or adding to or subtracting to from anything that I do. That's all I can say.
Who's up next?
Hey, I had a question for Robert. I was just wondering, like, one of the things that I found really interesting in the film was sort of studying that tension between, like, you guys as artists and then the music industry as a business. And I know, like, you're still touring and you're still making records and you have a son that's also signed to an independent label. And I was just wondering if you saw the music industry as a business as, like, wholly different to how it was when you guys were first starting, and also, I guess, if you still see that tension between, you know, being an artist and being a professional musician.
Have you still got the microphone?
Yes.
I got the end of the question about the difference between the music industry back when the band started and how it is now, through the prism of my son's band. But what's the other part of the question?
And just if it's different for you as a musician, still touring and still making records now, to how it was when you first started.
Okay. I think people make music for the same reasons now as they did back in late 70s. Just probably, you know, the same way that people in the late 70s were making records for the same reason that Buddy Holly was or Chuck Berry was. I think it's always the same impulse with music Kriv's making films for the same reason that, you know, like, Polanski is making films, or Billy Wilder made films. But the difference is circumstances and the era that you find yourself in. And for the go-betweens and for bands, basically in the 70s and 80s, there was always that feeling, which I don't think exists now, was back then, was that somehow like a very godmother, even if you're making avant-garde music, industrial music, someone was going to tap you on the shoulder and give you $200,000. And even if you're in a garret down in St. Kilda, you still sort of thought that you're in with a chance that you could be a pop star or a rock star. And that bands of all kinds, you know, like, got financed to make records. And you still live with the dream that you could be a full-time musician, even if you weren't selling 200, 300,000 records. The difference now is most of the musicians I know, including my son and his friends and other musicians I know, is that with the money sucked out of the music industry, there's still the desire to make music, but you just come with the assumption that you're not going to be tapped on the shoulder and given $200,000 or $100,000 or $300,000, that every musician has to have a part-time job, and that music's something that you do on the side, and that the main money that you earn is through playing gigs. So everyone's playing, and, you know, the rise of the festivals. The go-betweens played about 3 festivals all the way through the 80s. And now, you know, like, most middle ground bands play 3 festivals in a week. So, you know, playing live to stay alive is now the way, and you factor in that you're not going to be able to, you know, it's only 1% that make a full-time living out of music. But I think, as I said at the start, I think there's still the will for people to make music. You adjust and you do it with as much enthusiasm as it was done in the past, but you're doing it in different circumstances. And I think it's part-time jobs. It's treating music as something that's central to your life, but you can't make a living from it, and nothing's really going to fall from the sky to make it any different.
In the film, one of the really powerful things is the youthful kind of alchemy of these two songwriters who managed to protect that and stay very prolific throughout their lives. You've got another film in the festivals, and you are wildly prolific. How much do you credit to your environment, being surrounded by these guys or being surrounded by this kind of DIY?
Yeah, look, I remember reading something, and, you know, I don't think I'm a wanker by saying this, but I remember reading something that Ingmar Bergman said he only started making bigger films after making 20. And I think you only get better by working and by learning and by making mistakes. So to me, I still feel like I'm in my early stages and trying to make films and trying to learn and trying to be as productive as I can be with the resources that I have. So to me, every film is a journey, an adventure, and you learn and you're humbled by it. And some films work, some films don't. And you know, to me, I was always jealous. I must admit, I was always jealous of bands in the 80s. They could go into a recording studio within a week, produce an album, and an album for me was the equivalent of a feature film. And back in my time, feature films, we didn't have digital. We had 35mm or 16mm, and it was really expensive. And to make a feature film was really hard. And I always wished I was a musician. I wish I could just have that chance to sort of record an album really quickly, which is why I found the Go-Betweens really inspiring, because, you know, they went down to Melbourne and recorded this beautiful record called Send Me a Lullaby that was produced by Tony Cohen, who sadly passed away this week. And that energy, that idea that you could actually go out and do it, was something I found very inspiring. And that's always stayed with me. So to me, now that we have this wonderful thing called digital, we can shoot films and make films on our laptops, is very inspiring. But to me, it's more like the fact that the technology there is great, but it's still about the ideas, and it's still about learning and improving your own skills and your own knowledge of what you're doing. So to me, every film is a journey and every film is a discovery. So I hope that answers the question, please.
We've got time for one last question, but I'll just quickly say, do either of you guys have a question for each other you're curious to ask?
I will say, poor Robert, or the band, in that film, I interviewed these guys for like day. Robert, I interviewed Robert for probably about 6 days, 24/7. And for the month after I finished making the film, I went to sleep still interviewing. And it was a nightmare that I could never wake up. So I asked Robert too many questions. So it's a definite no.
All right, well, we'll leave it at that. Thank you everyone for coming, and thank you so much for coming.